So when we look at psychometric properties a little bit further, we want to make sure that we're going to take a couple things into account. Reliability, the extent for which scores are consistent. That's what reliability means. I took out all this other stuff because I think I've got a very simple way to help you understand it. The next thing we need is validity. And validity means that what I think I'm measuring is what I'm actually measuring. Let's say I have a self-esteem scale, and I've given it to lots of people, right? And now I can interpret it. If my mean is a 60 and my standard deviation is 10, right, then I have interpretation. If I give it to you today, I don't think your self-esteem is going to radically change in 30 days, right? It might fluctuate a little bit on any given day, but it's not going to plummet unless something particular happened. But on average, we should see stable scores, right? If we hypothesize that self-esteem is a stable construct, and that's what we hypothesize with intelligence, right? We hypothesize that intelligence ability don't fluctuate randomly and wildly. Well, then if I give you the test now, I should get a very similar score in 30 days, a year, etc., with some individual variation. That's reliability, but it doesn't mean that I'm actually measuring self-esteem. How do I know I'm measuring self-esteem? Well, I have to find other indicators of what good self-esteem or poor self-esteem might mean for a person, and then see whether scores on that measure actually predict outcomes. So if I think that I have an intelligence test, and I have, on average, some kind of ability to demonstrate where people fall on a continuum, then people who are higher on that continuum ought to be able to do certain things that people who are really low on the continuum may not do as well or might struggle to do. And we'll talk more about that on Friday, y'all. So we're talking about reliability, and we talked about consistency of scores over time. I was using the self-esteem example. Like if we had a measure of self-esteem and we assume that self-esteem is stable, and you take that measure today and it gives you a score of, say, 50, then we would expect you to take it at the end of a month and you would have a score, maybe not exactly 50, but near it. It wouldn't be dramatically higher or dramatically lower because we're thinking of self-esteem as kind of a stable construct. So we would see reliability would indicate that there'd be some consistency in measurement. But consistency doesn't mean that you're measuring what you think you are measuring necessarily. You could be measuring related or even unrelated things that are not necessarily exactly what you think you're measuring. So my example here in terms of validity, that's what we're talking about. Measuring what you think you're measuring is validity. That means it's valid. It's doing what you think it's doing. Now, if a test is valid, it's by definition reliable. But as I've been saying, just because it's reliable doesn't make it valid. And my layperson's example of reliability and validity and the difference between the two is this. If I step onto a scale and it registers 125, and I get off that scale, and I go over here for 5 or 10 minutes, but I don't eat anything, I don't go to the bathroom, and I come back on that scale and stand on it again, and it says 125, and I go and do it again, it says 125. That is an extremely reliable scale. It's measuring consistently the variable it's supposed to measure, you think, right? That's what it looks like. It's certainly doing it in a consistent format. There's reliability. But I don't weigh 125, so it's not a valid measurement of the variable in question, right? So if I get on it and it says, gosh, I don't know, let's say 218, right? And I go to my doctor's office and I hadn't eaten or gone to the bathroom, I get on their scale and it says 218, right? And then I go to another scale and it says 218, then I can have some confidence that my original scale was valid. Well, if it's valid, it means it's reliable because it is accurately measuring what it's supposed to measure, and thus it should do it time and again. So if the next day it measures 216, I'd have some confidence that I might have lost 2 pounds, maybe through loss of water or what have you, but the scale itself is not only reliable, but it's valid. Same thing applies to psychological tests. So we were saying I should have some kind of criterion to predict, right? If I think self-esteem is related to something else, then scores on my self-esteem measure should be related to those other things in ways that I would predict. If we're measuring intelligence, and I think I'm measuring intelligence, and we'll talk about how we can debate whether I'm measuring intelligence,
then my scores on the intelligence measure I use should then correlate or predict performance on different kinds of indicators on average. So if I have somebody who scores high on mathematical intelligence, I would expect them to score higher on mathematics tests, no matter what their age was, right? Because their ability would predict that they'd be able to do it well. And if it didn't predict that, now for any given individual, that might not be the case. I could have somebody with a high ability in mathematics who then scores poorly, but not because of their ability, but because they don't have motivation or they have other issues going on, right? But on average, I would see a correlation. Likewise, I could have somebody that looks like on paper they had a low ability in mathematics, but maybe they work really hard and they score higher on the tests. So you see that there's a relationship that would be predicted by my test if it was valid. And if it's valid, it should be reliable. But if it's reliable, it doesn't mean, by definition, it's valid. So theories of intelligence we can argue about. I'll show you a little video clip next time that's related to argument that I think illustrates that point. When we talk about some of the theories and constructs in psychology that we deal with on a regular basis, from a layperson's point of view, it may seem like we know exactly what the case is. But oftentimes, there are a lot of competing explanations, each of them plausible in their own way. To be plausible, they have to stand up to scientific scrutiny to be in our domain of psychology as a science. So we see that people theorize what intelligence really is. Well, I already told you and gave you a pretty long-winded explanation the other day that a lot of things could affect your test performance on any given day. Lots of variables might impinge on your test score, make it higher or lower, and that we don't have your true score, we have an estimated score, we need a confidence interval. And all of that taken into account, you see that there's a lot of question about precision. But given that we have a valid test, administered in a valid way, and interpreted correctly, we have a very good metric with a confidence interval. In other words, we have a score that we can say, yes, this is meaningful because we have a standardized group of norms that we're comparing it to. We know that our protocol was followed and that it was given in a standardized way. So the score is meaningful.